It's 8 p.m. on the 23rd of November, 1923. A button is pushed. The red light is on and radio begins in Australia. Radio station 2SB is on the air. And on that first night, a few dozen, maybe 100 or so listeners tune in to hear a concert. Free broadcasting, the newspapers proclaimed. News and entertainment for nothing. Big concert tonight. One of the performers on that opening night concert was George Saunders, a World War I veteran and popular singer who'd made his name as Uncle George, or the Story Man, by entertaining children in Sydney's hospitals. And in 1923, he became Australia's first professional radio announcer and Sydney's first radio celebrity. There were other singers and musicians on air that night as well. Sydney Pick, a Miss D. Deering, a Mr. Thorpe, Miss Thelma Druitt, and the St. Andrews Quartet. They performed a mix of popular songs of the day, just like the concerts of the time, except that this one was free. Well, sort of. Because although in November 1923, as the first station in Sydney, 2SB had the market to itself, in those days, listeners were locked on to just one station, and these radios were known as sealed sets, meaning that if you wanted to listen to another station, you'd have to pay an extra subscription, and potential listeners weren't allowed to buy a radio unless they produced the necessary certificates proving that they had paid the different subscriptions. It was hardly practical, and that was recognised from the very start. And that system wasn't to last very long, partly because some resourceful early audiophiles needed nothing more than a screwdriver to make the necessary adjustments to the internal workings of their radio to ensure that when other stations began broadcasting, listening options were expanded beyond just 2SB. And there were other, even more technologically advanced listeners who built their own radios at home, and they were called crystal sets. Those early broadcasts came from temporary studios in the Phillip Street offices of the popular and often outrageous newspaper of the day, Smith's Weekly, and another newspaper, The Daily Guardian. One of the original backers of 2SB was the colourful owner of those papers, Sir James Joynton Smith, a prominent businessman, donor to charity and sporting identity. On that first day of broadcasting, the Daily Guardian anticipated that one day radio would be taught in schools, that the radio set would be as familiar in the home as the domestic mangle, and one day radios would be in everyone's pocket, and a whole generation would grow up unconscious of a time when there had been no radio. The Guardian was confident of success, and that success would breed emulation, it said, but also that where 2SB led, others, it said, were welcome to follow. And that happened pretty soon. A second station was on air, unofficially in December of 1923, and then officially in January 1924. It was called 2FC, later to become Radio National, and it took its name from the well-known department store Farmer & Company, and broadcast its programs from the roof of the store's city building. And it was the similar-sounding names of the station's call signs, 2SB, 2FC, that led to a change of name. And so, on March the 1st, 1924, 2SB became 2BL, BL standing for Broadcasters Limited. Things were fairly rudimentary in those early days, but soon became more ambitious as the first manager of the station, W.J. McLardy, explained in 1973.
Our staff consisted of one announcer, Uncle George, that is George Saunders, myself and a secretary. Our program on 2SB commenced at 6 a.m. in the morning and was not completed until midnight. It consisted of news, quite a lot of pianola was used. That was one of the only electric pianolas in Australia at that time. Records and quite a number of talks were given during the day. At night time, from 8 till 11 o'clock, we used nothing but live program. Quite a number of the well-known artists used to appear on 2BL. After 11 o'clock, we played records until midnight. We were the first to ever introduce a time signal on 2SB, and that was the quarter-hourly broadcasting of the Sydney GPO clock.
At first, the aerial that broadcast the programs to listeners across the city was erected on top of a building in Macquarie Street. And as legendary broadcasting pioneer Len Forsyth, who installed the aerial, explained many years later, this had its problems.
The first one on a building called Craignish in Macquarie Street. The building was 11 storey, plus a 50-foot mast on top. The second one was on the King's Hall building, a 50-foot mast on top, a 10-storey building. One of the big drawbacks on this particular job was to go up and down in the lift on Craignish. It had to be done before 9 o'clock and after 4 o'clock because you interfered with the patients coming to see their doctors. So we discovered after one or two days that the water tanks on top of King's Hall and the parapet on Craignish was simply about 4 feet or 4 foot 6 apart. Providing you took a running jump and shut your eyes, you'd land on the parapet of Craignish. And this was our quick way of getting from building to building. Eventually, we were warned off because we were stopping the traffic, as the police said in Hunter Street, by people munching their lunch on the footpath, watching the acrobats jump from tower to tower at 12 o'clock every day.
2BL was originally broadcast at 857 on the AM band, and if you wanted to listen to it in those early days, you probably paid 19 guineas for an AWA radio set at Grace Brothers, or tuned in on one of those crystal sets. In fact, in those early days, that's how three-quarters of the listeners heard 2BL. Later on, the station moved its studio and aerial to the sandhills of Coogee, which required a massive effort to install a huge second-hand aerial previously owned by a Catholic priest who'd also been pioneering his own radio broadcasts. And what were 2BL subscribers listening to? Well, music mostly, either live or played from a record, with the microphone placed close to the gramophone speaker, and it was transmitted to air that way. Historian Philip Jeeves described how it all worked.
A needle had to be changed after each recording, and indeed occasionally sharpened on a little hand sharpener. The sound which came out of the horn in the front of the gramophone was then picked up by a very primitive carbon microphone, and of course the quality was appalling.
There was live music too, often under the direction of conductor Bernard Hines, later a major figure in the history of the ABC and the 1974 Australian of the Year. There were talks as well, both serious and amusing, and shows specifically for children, usually hosted by someone calling themselves auntie or uncle. And from as early as 1924 on 2BL, commentary and summaries of play from the Ashes tests at the SCG. The following season, that coverage had expanded to ball-by-ball descriptions similar to the way it's done today. News was read straight from Sydney's major newspapers, and often from copies of the paper bought from a newsagent or paperboy by the newsreaders themselves on the way into the studio. And the main news bulletin on 2BL wasn't allowed to go to air until just before 8 o'clock at night, so that the afternoon newspapers wouldn't be scooped on the big stories of the day. And no more than 200 words from AAP's overseas reports were allowed in each bulletin. After that tentative start in November of 1923, radio grew quickly. There were 130,000 listener licences issued in 1925, and more than double that just 2 years later. These licences cost 10 shillings, but in a situation very similar to the current day TV streaming platforms, listeners had to pay subscriptions to all the stations they wanted to listen to, and that was usually several pounds a year, a substantial amount in the 1920s. There was a fierce rivalry between 2BL and 2FC, and this led to some sometimes bizarre stunts designed to attract listeners, like broadcasting from down a coal mine in Balmain or from an aeroplane, with the pilot singing along to songs being played on a gramophone in the cockpit. And then there was the time that two divers sang a couple of appropriate songs from the bottom of Sydney Harbour. As early as 1926, 2BL was the first to try talkback radio, but they were hampered by technological drawbacks, and that now essential part of the radio experience wouldn't become commonplace until the late 1960s, and even later than that on 2BL. But there were many successful technological breakthroughs, things we take for granted today, but back then were important steps in radio's evolution. In 1926, programs were relayed through a shortwave station, which allowed 2BL to be heard up and down the east coast of Australia, and even as far away as New Zealand. In May of 1927, a landline allowed listeners in Sydney to hear the Duke of York, the future King George VI, open Parliament House in Canberra. In June 1928, Basil Kirk, 2BL's chief announcer, sports commentator and children's show host, stayed on air for 18 hours to report on the final leg of Charles Kingsford Smith's historic flight across the Pacific Ocean. Here's Philip Jeeves again.
Oh, Sydney, I love you. Oh, Sydney, I do. I love the smiling sky.
2BL stayed on the air all night. AWA, from its transmitting centre at Pennant Hills, was sending continuous Morse to give Kingsford Smith a homing signal. And seldom have people been so affected by anything. As people heard what was happening, they went down on their knees beside their sets and prayed for the safety of this crew, these Australians who were doing such wonderful things.
In March 1932, just a few months before 2BL would become an ABC station, there was a live broadcast from one of the most important events in the history of Sydney, the opening of the Harbour Bridge. Conrad Charlton, an actor, singer and broadcaster on both 2BL and 2FC, where he had a popular program about poultry, was on the scene to report live for 2BL. He was there from 5:30 in the morning until 10:30 at night. Many years later, he recalled the controversial events of the day and the response from listeners.
The guard was drawn up and the Premier was about to declare the bridge open and cut the magnificent ribbon when an individual dashed through the mounted guard and beat the Premier to it. What a debacle. A policeman rushed up to me and said, "Mate, Lang was beaten to it by one of the mob." I must confess, I, like so many others, was dumbfounded. I'll always regret that while I could tell the thousands listening, I could not say who had done the dirty deed. I must confess, I was sorry for J.T. Lang that such a thing could happen to him. It doesn't matter what your politics were at the time, Lang was a great man. Arising out of the broadcast some fortnight later, the commission was inundated with the mail from round the world, and particularly from New Zealand, where a total of 7,000 letters had to be answered. Many said how delighted they were with the announcer's adjectives as describing the man on the white horse slashing the ribbon. I remained all day to describe from time to time the various happenings that were taking place. Round about 2 p.m., the public were allowed to cross the bridge, preceded by a tram car, with Dr. Bradfield seated in a front row for all to see him. I will never forget the smile of triumph he bore of a job magnificently done.
The unexpected unofficial opening of the bridge by Captain Francis de Groot, a member of the prominent right-wing militia called the New Guard, well, that wasn't the only unusual thing to happen on the Harbour Bridge that day, as Conrad Charlton recalled.
Assisting me with the broadcast was dear old Red Gun, the gardening expert for the Sydney Morning Herald. At 6:30 a.m., when I asked him to speak of early days, he whispered in my ear, "I must change me pants and put on warmer ones." He stripped off and was as nature made him. I'm sure that he will go down in history as the only man who changed his pants 200 feet in the air and for all to see.
In those early days, there were two types of radio stations. A-class and B-class. And in 1929, the privately owned Australian Broadcasting Company owned all 12 A-class stations, and that included 2FC and 2BL. A-class stations were mostly funded by subscriptions and B-class stations by advertising. But that wasn't to last long, because the Scullin government proposed a BBC-like model, with the A-class stations essentially to be nationalised, and so the ABC was born. Things were made slightly difficult when the Scullin government fell in 1931, but the new Prime Minister, Joe Lyons, was also in favour of a government-funded radio network, with no advertising and what was described as high-quality programmes in the interests of the community. And it was to be funded by a licence fee, which would last for more than 40 years until the Whitlam government decided to dispense with it in the early 1970s. Interestingly, the idea that there'd be no advertising on the national broadcaster wasn't necessarily to maintain independence or purity of programming. It was more a concession to newspaper owners who didn't want to lose their advertising revenue. The ABC officially began on July the 1st, 1932. Already, there were more than 350,000 radio licences in Australia, which meant that about 2 million people in our then population of 7 million regularly listened to the radio. On that opening night of ABC Radio, the first voice heard was that of Conrad Charlton.
And our first broadcast was from studios originally the dressing rooms of Her Majesty's Theatre in Market Street, Sydney. On the opening day, announcer Con Charlton said these famous words.
This is the Australian Broadcasting Commission, relaying throughout Australia the opening night of the newly constituted Australian Broadcasting Commission.
And 24 years later, his son Michael was the first person to appear on ABC Television's opening night. After welcoming listeners to the ABC, Charlton handed over to Prime Minister Lyons, opposition leader Scullin and Country Party leader Earl Page, who emphasised how important rural and regional Australia would be to the ABC. And that has never changed. On air, 2BL presented a range of programs, plays, serials, music, lectures by university professors, and on Sunday, religious services, Bible readings, and non-denominational homilies. Family programs were also important, because the radio was usually the feature of lounge rooms across the nation. Interviews with guests were non-existent until accidentally pioneered by 2FC's Goody Reeve in the 1930s, when a visiting actor froze during a talk and had to be prompted by Goody in order to say anything at all. The ABC had orchestras, dance bands, military bands, and also conducted hundreds of community singing events from public halls. Music books and songsters, which featured the words of the songs from these community sing-alongs, sold in huge numbers, an early example of ABC-branded merchandise. There were also outside broadcasts, actualities as they were known, from Anzac Day marches and sporting events. Horse racing was particularly popular, although disputes with racing clubs sometimes meant that the callers often had to describe the races from outside the course, from ladders in neighbouring gardens or the roof of a block of flats.
And it's about the 2 furlong post. There's little between Induna and moving up well on the rails, Bo Nilly and then Rod Giller and Peter Pan coming into it. Oh, Yoramba will bolt him. He's come round the outside of the field and looks to have them all well beaten. Yoramba wins it all right. He's coming away from Peter Pan, who's finishing on a bit strongly. Now Peter Pan might get there. It's going to Peter Pan will win it. Peter Pan will win it. Peter Pan wins from Yoramba with Shadow King first.
The infamous Ashes cricket series, known as Bodyline in 1932-33, was hugely important in the history of the ABC, both in building a strong base of listeners and in cementing the connection between the national broadcaster and our national sport. And that continued with the 1934 Ashes Tour of England, with what were known as synthetic broadcasts, where cables or telegrams would come in at the end of each over with the details of what was happening on those faraway fields, and the action was then recreated in the Sydney studios.
Fast turns, runs in, volley to Bradman. Its ball well pitched, Brabham moves forward, drives. Cotton at cover tries to cut it off, but is beaten by the pace of the ball, and it races away for another four. Four more to Brabham, taking his score to 101. A century in 130 minutes, a glorious innings by us, and Australia is now building herself into a very sound position, assisted by a great knock by Brabham.
The timing of these tests was crucial too. They began too late Sydney time for the afternoon papers and ended too late in the early hours for the morning editions of the paper, meaning that the ABC had a monopoly on the latest information, a vital edge in those competitive times. At a time when newspapers were still selling in massive numbers, radio was advertised with the slogan, "Hear it today or be told about it tomorrow," which again emphasised the immediacy of the medium, something that continues to this day. And as early as New Year's Eve 1934, as the ABC was preparing for what would go to air in 1935, it was already asking its listeners for help and advice in improving its service.
"We are doing our best to improve broadcasting, and you can rest assured that we shall continue to explore every feasible avenue of advancement. If you'd like to help us along that difficult path, so much the better. But in any case, remember that we want 1935 to be a really happy year for Australia, and that we want broadcasting to play as big a part in that happiness as it possibly can."
In 1938, 2BL's rather haphazard programming became a little bit more standardised, with regular features at regular times. There was to be a serial at 8 p.m. on a Monday, a live play at 8 p.m. on a Thursday, with actors wearing formal attire, concerts on Tuesdays and Saturdays, sport on Saturday afternoons, religious programs on Sundays. This type of programming was an innovation from the United States. Although things didn't always go to plan, there were still complaints that programs often started or ended late, ran longer than planned, or were cancelled at the last minute, and there was no advertising or forward promotion to let listeners know what was coming up next. But all this was being done with a very small staff and limited budget. In 1935, there were only 21 people employed by the ABC, although that would grow to more than 100 by 1939. There were technical staff too from the old PMG department, something that wasn't phased out until the 1980s. 1939 was also the year that a definitive change occurred, and 2FC became a national station, and 2BL essentially became concerned with state-based issues. And there were other differences as well.
2FC Sydney was run, in a technical sense, by AWA, Amalgamated Wireless of Australasia. 2BL was run by the Postmaster General's Department. 2FC was considered then the highbrow station. 2BL was the popular station. The technical operators on the staff of AWA were not allowed to take their coats off except when they were wearing waistcoats. If they had a waistcoat on and it was a very hot day, they were allowed to take the coat off. In 2BL, they could work whatever they were wearing. When tea was taken by the AWA staff, they had to have saucers, and the teaspoon must be put on the saucer when you drank your tea. In the PMG department, you didn't have saucers. You didn't always take the spoon out when you drank from the cup.
An influential figure at the ABC at this time was Charles Moses, who later became general manager. In the 1930s, he was head of the talks department, and he had some very clear ideas about just how the ABC should operate. For example, the announcers were not to identify themselves by saying their names on air. Moses even went as far as to state that if the listeners wanted to know the presenters' names, they could write to the ABC and ask, and be told who was on air by return letter. All this was rather pointless, as the major names, like the irreverent and amusing morning announcer Herbert Watto Watts and the rather more solemn newsreader Heath Burdock, were well known to newspaper readers because of regular articles about them. Watts was a big name on Sydney radio, but tragically in 1937 he suffered a stroke while on air and died the next day. But worse times were ahead for the ABC and the nation. On September the 1st, 1939, Germany invaded Poland, and 2 days later, war was officially declared.
"Fellow Australians, It is my melancholy duty to inform you officially that in consequence of a persistence by Germany in her invasion of Poland, Great Britain has declared war upon her, and that as a result, Australia is also at war. No harder task can fall to the lot of a democratic leader than to make such an announcement.
You're with Rod Quinn, and this is our special presentation celebrating 100 years of ABC Radio Sydney. World War II would affect every aspect of Australian life and society, and the ABC was no different. Staff members joined the armed forces throughout the war, including Charles Moses. Blackouts, rationing, and limits on guests and live performances also had an immediate and direct effect on what the ABC could do. From the very start of the war, every word that went to air had to be scripted, and those scripts had to be approved by the Commonwealth Department of Information. Responding to listeners' demands, there was more news on air too. 5 bulletins a day in some cases, which was a change from the previous approach of usually just 1 in the morning and the main bulletin at 7 o'clock at night. And more news was coming from the BBC as the war raged in Europe. But that changed after Pearl Harbor and the war in the Pacific began, and a more Australian News First policy was introduced. This, along with the increasing fees charged to access their news from the newspapers of the day, saw the beginning of an ultimately successful push for an independent ABC News service. It was also around this time that the music of Advance Australia Fair was first used as the opening theme for ABC News bulletins. With an understanding that money was tight for everyone, the Menzies government cut the annual licence fee paid by radio listeners. But that fee was what funded the ABC, and a minor 1 shilling cut meant an annual loss of £100,000 to the ABC's budget. So, to cut costs, there were fewer local and now more national programs. And as part of the war effort, it was directed by the government that on-air talks were to contain no criticism of our national leaders. And some of those talks were written not by ABC staff, but by Department of Information bureaucrats, something that listeners weren't told at the time. There were some upsides, though, like an increase in the number of local musicians performing on air, although that was mostly because visiting overseas performers could no longer make the long and dangerous journey from Europe. And doing his bit for the war effort, the incredibly popular ABC dance band leader Jim Davidson joined up.
With 8 of the hits, a preview of a hit to be, and a flashback to a hit of yesterday, we present Jim Gussie and the ABC Dance Band in Australia's only live artist hit parade.
But other favourites who remained on air at that time and whose programmes filled the airwaves included comedian Dick Bentley and programme hosts Harry Pringle and Wilfred Thomas. Chester Wilmot was a legendary journalist whose reports from the many fronts of the war and what Australia's fighting men were doing were very much welcomed by listeners back home. At the start of the war, as it was to be for the next 50 years, the ABC in Sydney was never located in just the one place. Management offices weren't necessarily in the same buildings as the studios from where the broadcasts emanated. Some were in Market Street, others in Elizabeth Street. Broadcast House was in Pitt Street, and a new one was being planned for Forbes Street in Darlinghurst, with the special feature of a studio being built in an underground bunker, just in case of an enemy attack. As with all wars, important changes came that might not have happened otherwise. Because of the number of men who enlisted for service in the Army, Navy or Air Force, an increasing number of women were employed by 2BL. In Sydney, Basil Kirk ensured that a majority of the new employees were women. One of the women on air was Betty Higgins, who, many years later, spoke to Radio National about why it was important that listeners heard women's voices on air during World War II.
I had learnt that the ABC didn't really want women announcers, but they had to have them because the people who were listening in would not appreciate young male voices on air during the war. So they had to have, and had was underlined, had to have women.
Our political leaders were frequent guests during the war years, and things were certainly very different then.
When it came to looking at the script, I discovered that Mr. Menzies and Mr. Curtin had each been given 15 minutes each, and they couldn't have 15 minutes each because it was coming up to the 9 o'clock news, when, of course, the news had to go on irrespective of what happened. So I went to Mr. Menzies and I said to him, what am I going to do? And he said, look, leave it with me. He said, I'll tell John that instead of 15 minutes, he's got 10 minutes, and just leave it to me and I'll make up the time. Now, he said, when it comes a minute before I'm to be off the air, he said, just tweak my coat. And he said, when it comes to half a minute, just kick me on the shin, and then he said, I'll end off. John Curtin took the 10 minutes and did a perfect, marvellous job. Robert Menzies came on and he talked, and I tweaked him at the right moment, and I tweaked him again and kicked him on the shin, and he came off, rounded off his speech as though it had been meant for just that time.
Unfortunately, after the war, things went back to the way they'd been for the previous 20 years and probably would be for the next 20 years.
Fellow citizens, the war is over. The Japanese government has accepted the terms of surrender imposed by the Allied nations, and hostilities will now cease.
When it came to the end of the war, I had met my husband at that stage. We wanted to get married. And I went to them and I said to them, look, could I have a week off? I'd like to get married. And you'd have honestly thought that I had been telling them that I'd murdered somebody or something. They said, married? You know we don't have married women at the ABC. And so they said, I'm afraid we can't. And so, of course, I left the ABC.
New programs began on air too, influential ones like Guest of Honour, News Review and Radio Newsreel. But the most memorable to begin during the war years were a long-running serial and a show designed especially for children. The children's program was The Argonauts, interactive for its day, with listeners joining a special club, being given a special name and number, and they were encouraged to write in with stories, pieces of music and artworks, which were then assessed or judged by some of the foremost experts of the day, artist Jeffrey Smart and composer Peter Sculthorpe, most notably amongst many others. The Argonauts lasted on radio until 1972, and it's still fondly remembered today, although the program was mostly broadcast not on 2BL, but on 2FC.
I sat beside this wonderful wireless, 2 feet high, with a beautifully decorated front, and with my ear to it, and listened. Granite had a stroke. She used to listen with me, and I'd sit beside the wireless and listen to the Argonauts.
The serial, which outlasted the Argonauts, began its long run as The Lawsons and premiered on February 21, 1944. It was written by Gwen Meredith, and it was mostly a 15-minute-a-day, 4-day-a-week drama broadcast at lunchtime and repeated in the evening for those who missed it when they were out in the paddocks or in offices during the day. It too was chiefly on 2FC, but often turned up on 2BL, even into the 1970s. The program was a direct result of a request by Prime Minister John Curtin that there be something written specifically for people living in the country. But it caught on with city listeners as well. The storylines were mostly about rural issues, but of course the war couldn't be ignored. The Lawsons ran for 1,299 episodes before its finale on February the 25th, 1949, only for its successor, with pretty much the same cast but a much wider scope, to begin on the following Monday, February 28. Blue Hills, with that distinctive theme music, was the last of the great radio serials. That era was well and truly over by the time its 5,795th episode went to air on September the 30th, 1976. Appropriately, the last words spoken in the serial were by the great Queenie Ashton, who, incredibly, had spoken the first words more than 25 years earlier.
And so, you see, it isn't really so very hard to say goodbye. To say goodbye. To say goodbye and God bless.
And so ends Blue Hills by Gwen Meredith.
In August 1945, the war was finally over. But an interesting decade lay ahead for ABC Radio, because in the 1950s, a major rival would emerge when television came to Australia in 1956. In 1993, when celebrating the 70th anniversary of 2BL, then ABC Managing Director David Hill delved into the archives and chose the random date of April the 12th, 1946. He then revealed what was on air that day to an audience at a gala celebration event, and it was pretty much typical of the time.
ABC Radio didn't start until 7 o'clock in the morning, and the news came from news from the Sydney Morning Herald, cables from the Australian Press Association and the Sun Herald, and at 9:30 a.m, where nowadays we're used to Paul Lyneham and Andrew Wally, the network shut down. It reopened near lunchtime with the sunny serenades and community singing. And at 4:30 in the afternoon, there was a program called Chat Over the Teacups with Noel Brennan. At 5:30 p.m., the network shut down again. In the evening, the program told us that Lieutenant Colonel J.H. Renner will speak on Egypt in retrospect. This was followed by General Market Produce and Fruit Report, supplied by the Sydney Marketing Bureau, Wool Sales and Truck Bookings. Which I think just goes to show that even in those days, the ABC was capable of the odd inventive bit of program co-production. And finally, so Australians could go to bed secure and comfortable at night, they finished with the BBC News.
But a couple of important changes began in the late 1940s, and one was to have a major effect on the next four decades of 2BL, and that was the mandatory broadcasting of federal parliament. The other change was when the ABC finally created its own fully independent news service, and so no longer relied on local newspapers, overseas news agencies, and the BBC. And a decade later, we had bureaus in London, New York, Singapore and Port Moresby. That first independent bulletin went to air on July the 1st, 1947, 15 years to the day after the ABC officially began. The theme music was Advance Australia Fair until December the 31st, 1951. The following day, it was replaced by the now very familiar Majestic Fanfare.
Thank you.
The news on 2BL was always delivered by a man with a serious voice, and the story is told that the newsreader, even on the radio where no one could see him, apparently always wore a dinner suit. That idea later became a bit of a punchline in many ways about how stiff and formal the ABC was. But James Dibble, who would later become ABC Television's main newsreader from 1956 until 1983, but who'd read the news on radio before that, well, he says the dinner suit story wasn't always strictly true.
In those days, and even when I joined the ABC, you didn't just read the news, or you didn't just sit at the desk doing the announcing, doing time calls and so forth. You also had to go to other studios where you announced live broadcasts of musicians, musical groups and so forth. And those people liked to come and feel they were in the atmosphere of the theatre, and they'd come in their dinner suits. And so I think the ABC said, well, look, if you're going to announce these shows with these people, make them feel at home. You wear a dinner suit too. So you might be reading the news at 7, and you might have to go up to Market Street and announce one of these programs. So that legend goes on, you know, the newsreaders have to wear dinner suits.
The ABC's independent news service wasn't without its problems or restrictions, though. An extreme example of the restrictions that ABC reporters had to work under in the first decade of ABC News was that until 1958, they were not allowed to approach politicians without the express permission of the general manager. Extraordinary. Politicians, though, appeared on 2BL all the time, because between 1946 and 1988, the proceedings of both the House of Representatives and the Senate were broadcast whenever Parliament was sitting. That meant that hours and hours of many broadcast days were given over to the goings-on in Canberra. And to make matters worse, Parliament's hours just kept getting longer and longer. There was a 35% increase in broadcast time just from 1951 to 1952. There was nothing that 2BL could do about it, and it meant that announcers often had to wait in the studio doing nothing in case the House or Senate rose early. This went on until 1988, and it's no surprise that the modern success of 2BL really began when Parliament was moved to a dedicated radio network, these days known as News Radio, in 1990, after a couple of years on 2FC. The detrimental effect that the broadcasting of Parliament had on 2BL can't be overstated. It meant that there was no consistency of programming and no chance that listeners could get to know their favourite announcers, because regular programs disappeared from the airwaves for months at a time. The late 1940s and early 1950s saw the arrival of many familiar names and voices that would dominate 2BL airwaves for the next 30 years. James Dibble, John Chance, Martin Royal, Peter Dawes-Smith, Bruce Webster, Paul McCly, John West and Ralph Collins all had long careers doing all sorts of programs, from reading the news to hosting concerts, specialist programs, and in Martin Royal's case, becoming the ABC's soccer expert. But there was one important development because of the dominance of Parliament on 2BL, and that was a switch with 2FC as to the focus of the two stations. Prior to 1961, 2BL had been the serious station, and 2FC had been the home of light entertainment. But because of the preponderance of Parliament, 2BL often had to dispense with its serious talks, dramas and news programs, leaving it with only music and light entertainment to fill the hours between the sittings of Parliament. So 2FC, later Radio National, became the home of serious programs, and 2BL became lighter in its approach. As the 60s went on, that meant that there were many specialist programs, especially music ones. In the 1950s, though, things were different. In 1952, for example, there was a season of what were called notable long plays for Tuesday nights. Shakespeare, Molière and Bernard Shaw, although there was room for new playwrights as well, a season of the works of Arthur Miller as early as 1952, and many Australian works by the likes of Douglas Stewart, Ruth Park and Darcy Nyland, and the poet Rosemary Dobson. But in 1951, as a sign of the changing times, the ABC military band was disbanded, and that meant that there was more music on air from symphony orchestras. talks were on all sorts of subjects. What can be done to beat the bushfire menace was one. There was a hypothetical investigation of the fictional murder of a federal politician. There was a history of the Overland Telegraph, a look at life in Mexico, the Reith lectures from the BBC, the atomic bomb, even highlights of state parliament, as if federal parliament wasn't enough. They all went to air in just 1 week of October 1952. Programs began at 6 a.m. and closed at 11 p.m. There were Bible readings and complete operas and symphonies to keep listeners entertained throughout the day, with more of the same at night with a 15-minute news bulletin at 7 p.m. The Forum of the Air was a popular program and asked perennial questions like, is the Australian Aborigine getting a fair go in education? And is the Northern Territory neglected? For the children, Kindergarten of the Air was a long-running favourite.
Is it a lovely spring morning at your place today? Does it make you feel happy, like the birds?
Row, row, merry oars and row, that dangers lie ahead, we know.
And for many newcomers to Australia in those post-war years, English for New Australians was a 15-minute program at lunchtime on weekends. By 1956, with ABC television just weeks away, the sorts of programs broadcast on 2BL were still pretty much the same. Concerts, operas, piano recitals, talks, plays, Bible readings and Parliament, which included a repeat of Question Time, just in case you missed it earlier. Another major development in the post-war era was the arrival of the Country Hour in December 1945, which, although primarily broadcast on the regional network, was also regularly heard on 2BL. And the real breakthrough with this program was that announcers, like the show's first host, Dick Snedden, were allowed to have Australian accents. The directive from management was that these presenters needed to sound like the people they were talking to.
Hello, everyone. This is Dick Snedden of the Country Hour with a programme for the farm families of Australia. Today, an irrigation expert gives us timely information on farm water supply. We advise you of the price your produce realise in this capital city market. And following the national news at 12:30 Eastern Time, we give you weather forecasts in your particular district for the next 24 hours. And at 12:48 Eastern Time, we take you across to Tasmania to hear about the exhibits at the Launceston Show. These rural ingredients are blended for relaxed listening with the best of music from star pianist Dudley Stapleton, who now plays I Miss You So.
There was also the hospital half hour, later extended to an hour and lasting on air until the 1970s. It was first hosted by the much-loved Russ Tyson, who sounded, it was said, as Australian as a gum tree, and then, much later, by Gary Ord. 2BL's regular announcers, though, usually spoke in an English accent, either because they were English or because that's the way it had always been done and that was what listeners expected. Well, as early as 1948, there were complaints from the board that there was too much sport on 2BL. But as Charles Moses argued, it brought listeners in who wouldn't otherwise tune into the ABC. And figures showed that the first Ashes series after the war, in 1946-47, 76% of the Australian population tuned in at some stage during that summer. And that's bigger numbers than those who were watching the Matildas this year. In early pioneering efforts, the ABC sent Talbot Duckmanton to the 1950 Commonwealth Games in Auckland.
Hello everyone, this is Talbot Duckmanton speaking.
And Bernard Kerr to the 1952 Olympics in Helsinki. Alan McGilvray, for 40 years the voice of cricket for the ABC, actually spent time at commercial stations as well, as early as 1948 and as late as 1963. And by 1972, there was all-night coverage on 2BL from the Munich Olympics. Bible readings to start the day, concerts and operas and talks until closing time. The winds of change wouldn't blow through the new premises at Upper Forbes Street until the end of the 1960s, even allowing for that change to a lighter format in 1961. But in 1967, a young woman would put a little crack in the glass ceiling at 2BL, and her name was Margaret Throsby. She'd first applied to work in the children's department in 1965, but was turned down because she was a woman. 2 years later, she applied again, and this time was successful. By the end of the 1960s, programs on 2BL had begun to change, and after the arrival of TV, radio sets were no longer large pieces of furniture that dominated a lounge room. Listeners were now tuning in on portable and transistor radios, and in their cars as well. There were radios in kitchens, on bedside tables, and in the rooms of teenagers. In Sydney, 2BL was the ABC's flagship, but it was also just one of 83 ABC radio stations across the country. The Morning Current Affairs program, AM, debuted in September of 1967.
This is the ABC's new morning program, AM.
And its evening stablemate, PM, in 1972, although for more than a decade, PM was only heard on 2FC.
The first edition of PM, John Highfield reporting.
AM brought the world to 2BL listeners, with correspondents throughout Europe, the Americas, the Pacific and Asia. It differed from its predecessors by presenting shorter, pacier stories, some of them lighter and amusing, in line with its TV counterpart, This Day Tonight.
PM presents
A History of ABC Radio. Dum da da dum 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 da da dum 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 dum
dum dum.
On a very low budget, Rosemary.
Thank you, Tony, that's right.
And like TDT, the greatest journalists of their times worked on that program. It was an immediate success. News, though, was still mostly confined to just two major bulletins a day, with two-minute updates on the hour. One of those updates became very famous, or perhaps infamous. It was on November the 18th, 1971. Announcer and newsreader Rod McNeil found himself in the studio with comedian Spike Milligan, well known to 2BL listeners for The Goon Show, which had been broadcast here for nearly 20 years.
The highly esteemed Goon Show!
Rod McNeil explained how it all came about.
But he'd been in the studio being interviewed on the programme, which I think was still called Mainly Music, which Peter Young did for most of its run. And it just so happened that I took over from Peter at about 11 a.m. also to play music. That programme normally began with a news in brief, which went everywhere on the ABC network. And Spike Milligan had been a guest of Peter's that morning, and I remember Peter said to him a good 25 minutes before his show was due to end, "Well, Spike, I know you're a busy man, better let you go." "Oh, no, I'm not busy," he said. "I'm quite happy to stay." And he did stay until finally the programme finished, and he is still there. As the time pips went, really, I sort of dashed in with my bit of copy to read the news in brief, and Spike Milligan was seated at the table where I had to sit while before Peter had a chance to vacate the main console, and I started reading this bulletin. And, I mean, it was just the most wonderful opportunity for him to have something to say about it. So he started almost immediately, too, interjecting with tiny comments. I cast the odd glance at Peter, who was still in the studio at the main microphone switches and at the desk, and he was sort of doing shh signs to Spike. So there's no way in the world that Spike Milligan knew that he wasn't up to something. But that didn't quieten him. It just went on. You know, the news and brief went on for the next 2 or 3 minutes with the note in my voice rising somewhat as I tried to contain my mixture of anxiety and humour. And Spike's comments kept on coming. You know, the telephone started ringing from a couple of newspapers, and ABC bosses started appearing, you know, sort of saying, "Look, we know that you did your best, but you probably did the wrong thing," they're saying, "and Spike Milligan, because that's involved us." And I subsequently learned that Spike had been banned from ABC Radio. I don't think they ever told him, though. The thing settled down, needless to say, but has never been forgotten. It's extraordinary.
The news in brief. The Prime Minister, Mr. McMahon, arrived back in Australia today after his overseas tour. He told newsmen at Sydney Airport that he could not have had more valuable discussions with both President Nixon and the British Prime Minister, Mr. Heath.
What about Spike Milligan?
But he refused to give details of the discussions before he had spoken in the House.
What about Spike Milligan?
Mr. McMahon also refused to comment when asked about criticism of him by two former ministers, Mr. Gorton and Mr. Killen.
And Spike Milligan?
The Prime Minister was met at the airport by his two children and members of the Cabinet, including the Treasurer, Mr. Snedden, and Spike Milligan. The Australian Post Office is doing good business in the United... in the United States.
What?
An agent for the Post Office in New York says sales of stamps to collectors could bring in $200,000 in the first year of business. The South Australian Attorney General, Mr. King, has warned that people in the state who stock or sell a New South Wales publication, Searchlight, run the risk of prosecution. Mr. King said the three issues of the publication that he had seen were obviously very offensive to a great many people. Mr. King was speaking in the South Australian Parliament.
Where there was nobody listening.
More news in 1 hour.
You'll never make it.
There were complaints, of course, from listeners and management, but these days it's one of the great moments in the history of 2BL. Also in 1971 came a program that went to air late at night, before 2BL closed down at midnight. It was called Room to Move and was hosted by Chris Winter.
If you didn't catch this act from the top and you wonder what the hell's going on, it's ABC National Radio. I'm Chris Winter and this is Room to Move.
In some ways, it was a preview of what would happen with Double J just 4 years later. But it was also perfect late-night listening for those who'd like their modern music treated with some respect and intelligence. The program was hugely influential and is still talked about 50 years later. Other late-night hosts included Holger Brockman, who was also the first voice on Double J in 1975, and the smooth-as-silk Bob Hughes. In 1973, 2BL celebrated its 50th anniversary and, just a few weeks earlier, had broadcast the opening of a new landmark for Sydney, the Opera House. It was Symmetry, because 50 years earlier, 2BL had also been there for the opening of the Harbour Bridge.
I join with you, Mr. Premier, in paying tribute to the many people whose devoted efforts and inspiration over more than a decade have combined to bring this unique conception to fruition. I have much pleasure in declaring the Sydney Opera House open.
In late 1973, as radio in Australia and 2BL in particular celebrated their 50th birthdays, there was a slogan used to promote that celebration. 50 fabulous years and the best is yet to come. In 1974, as it had been for much of the previous 50 years, 2BL was a solid flagship station for ABC Radio. It presented good, worthy programs highlighting the best music, information, sport and entertainment from around Australia and the world.
2BL.
Often these were specialist music shows, like those presented by ABC legends Arch McCurdy, Relax With Me, John Carger's Singers of Renown, Eric Child and Jim McLeod's jazz programs, and John West's Sentimental Journey and The Showman, all of which have an important place in the history of 2BL and the ABC. For the most part, the program presenters, or announcers, or specialists as they were known, were dignified, formal, and fit into what was certainly a recognisable ABC mould. Then came Clive Robertson, and he broke that mould and became both the first of a new breed of announcer, but also totally original, a one-of-a-kind who is still fondly remembered today by listeners who tuned in each morning for his philosophical musings and quirky observations on life.
2BL.
It's 12 minutes past five. This is an album of Dinah Shore when she could sing. It sort of summarises Monday morning. Imagine waking up, your wife having had the umpteenth headache and you're wondering what it's all about as you search for your little cache of Playboys, for your excitement for the day. And you open the window
and you've got a hangover. Imagine the feeling.
He won fans from other stations too, and not just listeners from commercial radio who tuned in to find out what the fuss was all about, but also other breakfast presenters from those stations who described Clive as brilliant, bordering on genius, different, refreshing, our youngest eccentric, a communicator, a humorist. He had his likes and dislikes, there were passions and a healthy dose of cynicism too. His music choices were off the wall at times, but the part of the program that people still talk about was when he had a short discussion with the morning show host about what was coming up on her program.
It's 26 past 7, and here's MT after an empty long weekend where she didn't work here.
It wasn't empty of activity.
Wasn't it?
No.
Oh, you're at it again, you little beast.
I was surfing over the weekend.
Surfacing?
No, surfing.
Surfing where? Surfing. What, a North Sydney pool?
No, I was surfing at Avalon, actually.
Why would you want to go surfing at Avalon?
Because I was staying at Avalon with friends.
You know I don't have friends, and you always mention friends all the time, you know that
I was thinking of you on the beach and thinking that you would really like a beach like Avalon.
Would I?
I think you should come surfing with me one weekend.
No, I don't know. I
you can use my polystyrene board.
When you say it like that, you know it's hard to refuse. Can I practice in the bath with it?
No, you
Why
can't.
Why not? I could fill it up and roar down one end or the other and bash my head on the tap.
Depends on the size of the bath.
Well, I suppose it would, wouldn't it? I'm not what you'd call a miniature human being. It might be rather difficult.
I'd like you to become a bronzed Aussie with me and come and be dumped.
Bad for your skin to get all brown.
It's nice to get lightly tanned.
Is it?
Mm. Looks nice too.
Is it?
Mm. I think you'd look delicious with a bit of a tan. Could I tell you what's on City Extra this morning?
I think you should.
2BL. The remarkable thing about these sometimes very personal discussions was that the two people involved were never in the same studio. They weren't even in the same building, but in different parts of the ABC on opposite sides of William Street. And yet, it worked. Eventually, Clive Robertson, like so many ABC stars before and since, went commercial, to some success, especially on TV. But he never again caught the public's imagination the way he did on 2BL from the mid-70s until the early 80s. Clive's sparring partners during that time were two highly respected and much-loved broadcasters. First, Caroline Jones, and later, Margaret Throsby. They presented City Extra, the prototype of the radio programs of today. A mix of stories, interviews, music, and, for the first time, talkback calls from listeners.
You know, I've never met an elf except this one, but I'm perfectly certain that he's an interior decorator, very clever.
You're with Rod Quinn, and this is our special presentation celebrating 100 years of ABC Radio Sydney.
In Sydney, it's 2BL for better listening.
Margaret Throsby had joined the ABC in 1967 and had gradually made her way to the morning program on 2BL after presenting a variety of shows over more than a decade. One of them was the pioneering but short-lived Let's Find Out.
Was hosted by Ellis Blaine. It's a morning program Monday to Friday with a co-host who was a woman. And that was quite groundbreaking. He had a different woman every morning and some great names. Sheila Scotter was one of his favourites. Diana Fisher was there. Frieda Leslie was a very intellectual woman and brought a lot of heft, intellectual heft to the program. And they talked about subjects that were chosen by Ellis. Current affairs-ish, magazine-ish, but it was groundbreaking in the sense it was the first of its kind on the ABC. When I was one of the co-hosts with him, he'd send a couple of days earlier by mail, or we'd talk on the phone, the subjects I want to talk about are how we get pneumonia and what is the latest research on gold mines in Africa. You know, that sort of stuff. You'd do the research and you'd come in and talk about it.
Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning, Diana.
Good morning, Ellis. Well, now, to talk about today, we have quite a list of extraordinary items. First of all, the Loch Ness Monster.
Genocide in Tasmania.
Some party invitations and some listeners' letters.
Is the Berlin Corridor on again?
And part two of The Secret Thoughts of a Happy Husband.
But although talkback, phone-in, open line had been a feature of commercial radio since the late 1960s, it hadn't really been embraced by 2BL until more than a decade later. These days, there's a 10-second delay when callers ring in so that presenters can make sure that nothing offensive or defamatory goes to air. In the old days, it was a 7-second delay. Surprisingly, it was weatherman and gardening expert Alan Humphreys who was the first presenter on ABC Radio to use the dump button to get rid of a caller, and for an unexpected reason, as he explained to current morning's host, Sarah MacDonald.
I said, you know, it's 8 minutes past eight. Barry in Balmain, your question, please.
G'day, yes. I want to know, is it possible to bonsai marijuana plants? Now, Alan Seal at that point reeled back from the microphone, lost all the blood in his face. And as you know, Sarah, in radio, you don't have dead air. I can see nothing was going to happen with Alan Seal for a couple of seconds, so I jumped in, as you normally do, and said, what's the background of this? And he said, g'day. It's like this. I've got these marijuana plants growing in the back garden, and they're getting a bit too tall, and I'm afraid the police can spot them over the fence, and I want to know, can I reduce the height but not affect the yield? Now, at that point, I realised that perhaps my short career in the ABC was going to be even shorter. And that was the point that I hit the dump button. And that was the first time that the dump button had been used on ABC radio.
Is that right?
You turn me on, I'm a radio, I'm a country station, I'm a little bit corny, I'm a wildflower waiting for you, broadcasting town.
Often, though, programs weren't just being cut short by a few seconds, but for hours at a time when Parliament was being broadcast. And Parliament could rise with very little notice, as Margaret Throsby often experienced.
It was just awful. We hated it because I was doing the afternoon show, and when Parliament was sitting, you just lose your program. And you couldn't say, well, I'll take a day off and stay home. You had to sit in the studio and listen to Parliament, because if the network between Sydney and Canberra broke down physically and Parliament went off, or if Parliament rose early, you had to be ready to scramble. And there's some hilarious stories, particularly one that I remember with Arch McCurdy, who was running an evening, a nighttime program, 10 till 12, called Relax With Me. And he was one of the most influential, gifted broadcasters I've ever met. But Arch had this wonderful program which was called Relax With Me, and it was very laid-back, gentle music, but it kept getting interrupted by Parliament, because if Parliament sat until late, Arch might get to air at 20 past 11 and he's got a program till midnight. But he had to be there at 10, and one time I was there in the supervisor's office, and there was this terrible racket as Arch came charging down the hall with his big case full of LPs, and it was about 3 minutes to 10 and Parliament had got up and we were filling up to 10 o'clock so that Arch could take over. And he came rushing in, queued up a record, and he'd come up the steps and broken all the rules by running up steps and was out of breath. And so instead of saying, hello, this is Arch McCurdy inviting you to relax with me, he said, hello, this is Arch McCurdy inviting you to collapse with me.
Afternoons, when Parliament wasn't sitting, were often filled with hours of Sheffield Shield cricket, horse racing previews and scratchings, and music programs, and there were book readings as well. In the evenings, though, there was something a little bit different happening. As idiosyncratic as Clive Robertson had been in the morning, Bob Hudson was at night.
Alan O'Day and Skinny Girls, which has just been released in the last couple of weeks as a single. Suppose that means it'll be yet another hit. Where did you hear it first? Oh, really? And then we played it. Yes, I would have thought as much.
Although Parliament often intruded there too, and we still heard British comedies like I'm Sorry I'll Read That Again, Round the Horn and The Men from the Ministry, Bob Hudson also had themed nights that helped popularise trivia in Australia. There was the Trivia Quiz with David Lyle and sometimes his brothers Richard and Jonathan, and on a Friday night, Glenn A. Baker with music. This was an approach to radio that was way ahead of its time and highly influential because the huge success of the board game Trivial Pursuit and the explosion of trivia nights at pubs and clubs and school fundraisers in Australia were still quite a few years away, and the programs encouraged plenty of calls from listeners keen to match wits and knowledge with Glenn A. Baker and the Lyle brothers. And yet, despite the successes at breakfast, mornings and evenings, 2BL still wasn't a radio station as we know it today. It was more a broadcast platform for a disparate collection of ABC departments. In one typical morning, programs might be produced by the Light Entertainment Division, or Current Affairs, Sport and New South Wales programs. All this was going on at Upper Forbes Street and William Street in Darlinghurst, while management was in Elizabeth Street in the city. But that began to change when Mike Jeffries, a veteran of commercial radio, took over as station manager. He began the biggest change in the station's history. Music was out and talk was in. And of course, 2BL's critics did not like it one bit. They hated everything, from the rebranded name, from Radio 1 to 702BL, to the sound. Too commercial, it was said. Too concerned with trivia and self-promotion. But the switch from music to talk was an acknowledgement that the radio landscape had changed with the advent of commercial FM in 1980. And listeners who wanted pop music were tuning out of 2BL and tuning in elsewhere. Mike Jeffries also took on the role of presenting breakfast, or sometimes mornings, often with a co-host. That double duty was common at the ABC's regional stations, but not in the city. It was later said that he tried to do too much too soon, and maybe he didn't do anything wrong, he just did it first. But the reality was that his approach didn't work. And what couldn't be ignored was that 2BL was no longer connecting with its audience, and something else needed to be done. And in November 1986, when the ratings fell to just 2.9%, it was obvious that things had to change again. And that change was a dynamic new manager named Peter Wall.
It was the most exciting time of my life. I can remember I was so busy in the first 3 or 4 months of managing the new 2BL, call it 702BL, I think, that I didn't have time to find the light switch for my office, and I used to go off the glow of the Coca-Cola sign at the top of King's Cross because it was such a busy time, but a time that I'd never give up. The most exciting time of my professional career just was to see that the troops were coming with me and that it was all happening and have a cohesive crew that were also dedicated and excited about the opportunities that we faced.
It was in with the old and the new as veteran radio and TV star Ray Taylor took over as breakfast host.
Ray Taylor is no relation to Ray Charles, Ray Milland, Ray Warren, Raymond Chandler, Ray Price, Johnny Ray, Carol.
And respected TV journalist Andrew Ollie presented the morning program from 8.30 to 9, which was later extended to 10 a.m.
Now, from 8.30 to 10, Andrew Ollie brings you the news that becomes news.
And the main thing about that program was to have a very strong look at our city every morning for half an hour, cover the stories that everybody was talking about, the front page stories, not the page seven stories, as you were. And he was just instantly a success.
Current Affairs veteran Peter Thompson was the new drive presenter. But Margaret Throsby remained, and there was still music at night with Holger Brockman and Bob Hudson.
Because your world is constantly changing, 2BL brings you the team with a world of experience. With over 20 years as a presenter, Holger Brockman knows your music like no one else.
But Peter Wall had bigger ambitions. He wanted 2BL to go 24 hours. He wanted the staff to be all located in the one place, and most important of all, he wanted to finally get rid of Parliament and non-essential sport. He found a willing ally in Managing Director David Hill. Hill had previously been chair of the ABC board and had been in charge of the New South Wales Railways. Now his job was to make 2BL run on time.
Well, David Hill was a pretty full-on sort of character. In fact, he was a wonderful change agent. And he said to me, you've got to make this work or something to that effect. And I said, well, good, I can if you take Parliament off the air and get 24-hour broadcasting. And he looked at me and he thought, okay. And to his credit, he managed to do both. With 24-hour broadcasting, he said that we're going to go to 24-hour broadcasting in 6 weeks or something like that. And Telecom said, it can't be done. You know, we can't do it for a whole range of reasons. So he said, okay, 8 weeks or something like that. So he just pushed it. And it's all David Hill did it. But it was great because he delivered what I needed. You know, a station's not a station when it closes down.
All this coincided with ABC Radio's move from its many homes in William Street, Upper Forbes Street, Elizabeth Street and King's Cross to a new purpose-built facility in Harris Street, Ultimo. Another major programming decision at the time was to provide the same kind of intelligent and engaging talk at night as there was during the rest of the day. And so Tony Delroy launched Nightlife from the 2BL studios, a program he was to host for the next 26 years and which continues under Philip Clark to this day.
I essentially said to them, look, what I want to do is I want to make it listening that you want to stay up for. So I understand, you know, the general theme is that we're playing music to relax people and put people off. I said, I don't want to do that. I want to talk and I want to be interesting.
Tony Delroy also found that at this time, technological improvements were making things easier for presenters and producers.
Just the ability to direct dial, which was fairly extraordinary. You know, this is a long time before mobiles, but you sort of remember in that sort of 60s, 70s period where if you wanted to ring London or you wanted to ring Perth, you had to ring an operator. Direct dialing was an amazing option, and all of a sudden it, you know, became possible to communicate with the nation.
Radio stations generally follow each other with the same news, the same information, the same music, the same stories, the same experts, the same entertainment, and the same issues. But when you want to turn from the flock, turn to 2BL. Intelligent, credible, entertaining, informative, and independent, bar none. Stay tuned to the best. In Sydney, this is 2BL.
A massively important change to 2BL at this stage was that there were no longer as many specialist programs on air, music in particular, but programs of 2 or 3 or sometimes 4 hours with just one host who spoke to a range of guests and didn't play anywhere near as much music. So many of the names of those program hosts are still familiar after all these years, and they made an important contribution to how ABC Radio Sydney sounds today. Breakfast has always been the highest profile program on ABC Radio in Sydney. Before Clive Robertson, there was Steve Cosser and Barry Friedman, father of Tim Friedman from the Whitlams. Then later, Mike Jeffries and Ray Taylor. David Dale and Philip Clark brought a solid news-based approach to the program.
Good morning, Philip Clark with you here on 2BL on a day which promises to have an afternoon change.
Later, Adam Spencer brought an analytical, almost mathematical approach.
Thanks for coming along. Give yourselves a round of applause for being here.
And Robbie Buck and Wendy Harmer provided laughs along with the news. Angela Caterns came across from Triple J and hosted evenings before working at the other end of the day to take on breakfast to spectacular success.
Marty, good morning to you.
Oh, good morning, Ange. Love your show.
Good on you, thanks.
Good morning, Ange. I spent every morning with you and love it.
Oh, bless you. Thank you for that, sir.
Oh, Angela, the goddess of morning radio.
Oh, my goodness.
She hit number one in the ratings, knocking off the then king of breakfast in Sydney.
I came off air and, you know, it was ratings day, so we're expecting the station manager to come in, you know, brandishing sheets of paper and say, well, we went up a bit or we went down a bit. But I remember them coming to my desk. I've come off air, I'm sitting at my desk. You've gone to number one, Ange.
Well,
what do you mean? Number one in what? As opposed to what? Anyway, yes, you have won the ratings. You've beaten Alan Jones. And this was his 100th survey, by the way. He had won the previous 99 surveys, but his 100th survey, I won. And it was quite amazing. And so, of course, there were, you know, masses of cheers all around. The then ABC managing director, Russell Balding, came down with a cheap, warm bottle of champagne, which we all shared, even though it's, you know, 9, 10 o'clock in the morning. And then there were calls from the various newspapers and a call from Alan Jones himself. And he said, "Congratulations, well done. We must have a cup of tea sometime."
Did you ever have a cup of tea with Alan Jones?
No, I did not. He didn't follow up and neither did I.
David Dale was a success at breakfast and on evenings, as was Philip Clark. At Drive, it was Peter Thompson. Then, for nearly a decade, Frank Crook, before Mike Carlton made a return to the ABC for a couple of years, and who was then succeeded by Richard Glover in 1998, who is still going strong 25 years later. He sees ABC Radio Sydney as this city's town square.
It's really a response to this derision about mainstream media. There's a sort of view that, oh, terrible mainstream media, it's terrible. We get our news from Twitter and we get our news from Facebook. And that's all very well, except if you do that, then your news is absolutely filtered for you and you only hear the voices that you've already heard before and they are amplified. It's like a pre-Copernican world in which everyone is an Earth around which all planets revolve and you're the centre of everything and everyone's got your musical taste and everyone's got your political taste and everyone thinks the same thing about vaccines because you've built that for yourself and there's no interrupting it. And the great thing I think about something like the ABC is one of the last remaining places which is not an echo chamber, where you can walk in the town square and on a good day you'll hear somebody who's older than you, you'll hear someone that's younger than you, you'll hear someone who's a different gender to you, you'll listen to somebody who's got a different politics to you. And that seems to me the glue of society. And without that, I don't know how we function as a society.
On afternoons, perhaps following in the idiosyncratic footsteps of Clive Robertson, was John Doyle, who succeeded John Woods in 1989.
The way to refresh is an afternoon with John Doyle.
Invisible? I'll say it's invisible. Wait, what are we talking about here? There's no dark matter there at all.
Every weekday afternoon from 2, John Doyle pours you the finest blend of people, news, music and issues, leaving you relaxed, informed and ahead.
Because there's a lot of light matter here. We've got to imagine there's probably some dark matter there anyway. Is that how it works?
Stir in John Doyle. Weekdays between 2 and 4 here on The Sound of Sydney, 2BL 702.
Doyle's curious, inquiring mind and quiet, patient style was the complete opposite to the Roy Slaven character he'd created as part of a double act with H.G. Nelson on 2BL's youthful stablemate, Triple J. He was succeeded by Angela Webber, Kirsty McIver and Liz Heath before James Valentine brought his unique style to the afternoons. But John Doyle and James Valentine had differing approaches to their programs. John Doyle didn't take talkback calls, while James Valentine loved that kind of interaction. John Doyle.
I always thought talkback radio was an excuse for a better idea. And for those who sit around all day, and I take my hat off to them, I couldn't do it, coming up with topics you're going to run with that day. You know, which sock do you put on first, left or right? You know, give us a call. Well, to me, this was just a stupid idea. I could never warm to it. When there was such a great resource in universities, experts everywhere, and more than happy to talk, love being spoken to, love being asked, who can bring a level of expertise into something you might be halfway interested in, something that might be worthwhile learning about. So I was more interested in the, you know, creating a sort of educational tapestry, for want of something else, and this may well have come from the producers as well, that for me it was an opportunity to learn something today.
James Valentine.
I was on in afternoons, and what I noticed was that if we did the news of the day, I would end up talking to Australia's fifth leading expert on the topic. That just didn't seem very relevant. So I started to drop doing the news, and then I started to think, I really like callers. I really like talkback, but I don't like the sort of, what do you think of the government's decision? I don't like that talkback. And so I started to devise these ways of getting them to tell me stories about their life. What's the worst wedding you've ever been to? And so you collect these sort of fantastic stories on bizarre weddings. And as I went on, I found I could get them to tell me very personal things, complain about their partners, make up stuff. We once did a whole talkback which ran very regularly, which imagined we were set in the future. Call me from 2440, as though you're a caller in 2040. So I got this great imaginative burst and revelatory burst from talkback. I think one of the tricks to that sort of talkback is to have a sort of gang, you know, it might be 100 people or something who call quite regularly. I suspect that quite a few of them are sort of improvising comedians and actors who are quite happy to sort of go, oh, I can call that one. Yes, James, well, I was at a wedding once, you know, possibly making stuff up. But it's more like you've got a small group, a coterie, who are devoted to calling. And then the other trick is to do something that's really specific. You know, what's your worst camping trip? That's campers, you know.
John Doyle was better known to many listeners as the character Roy Slaven. But a piece of advice that he was given very early was that John Doyle should be a kind of character too.
The most influential thing for me as a broadcaster was Peter Wall had a terrific idea to have someone come in and mentor us. And the mentor I ended up with was Arch McCurdy. And Arch McCurdy had been a great family favourite for us to listen to back in the, I want to say, early 60s. And he told me, you have to find a performance mask. Some days you don't feel so well, but if you have a performance mask, it's just something you slip on and you can be reliable and regular. This was an important lesson to learn, that you can't just come in one day feeling over the moon and the next day be down in the dumps. Listeners won't react to that at all in a positive sort of way. And the other thing he taught was to use silence, to allow silence to work. And this was a great revelation as well. You've got to be confident to use silence. Great broadcasters I listen to are those who can use the odd silence well. That was the lessons I learned from Arch McCurdy.
Angela Caterns was also mentored by Arch McCurdy.
And he told me something that I thought was really fantastic. I still think of it to this day, and it was that you are not Lady Bountiful. It is not about you handing out your gifts to your audience, to your listeners. I am going to give you this. I am going to play you that. I am going to speak to this person now, and you will listen. And I have borne it in mind ever since.
On evenings, lawyer and stand-up comic James O'Loughlin was impressed by John Doyle's approach. And he'd never really listened to 2BL before finding John Doyle's program.
It completely changed my conception of what radio was, because he was creating a dynamic with his guest that was interesting, it had a hint of danger. He was kind of serious and kind of taking the piss at the same time, and you didn't really know which way it was going to go, and you just had this feeling anything could happen. And I thought, that sounds exciting and fun, and that's not what I thought AM radio was.
And John Doyle brought some of his experience as a collaborative actor to his radio program, that the guest on the program was just as important as the host.
A bloke interested in whomever was in the room with him at the time was the central person. That was the person. And you did all you could to make them the hero, to make them look and sound good. And that is the spirit of ensemble. The spirit of ensemble acting is something that Greg and I have both come from, a theatre background of ensemble. You do your level best to make the person with whom you're working look good. And you make the assumption, the leap of faith, that they're doing the same for you. And when that happens, you end up with something larger or greater than the sum of its parts. Great shows, great theatre experiences come from people working to make the others look good.
Apart from James O'Loughlin, evenings has been the home to a succession of high-profile hosts over more than three decades. Peter Luck, Philip Clarke, Lisa Forrest, Angela Caterns, Christopher Lawrence, Andrew Daddo, Dom Knight, Christine Arnoux, Robbie Buck, Chris Barth, Sarah McDonald, and Indira Naidu. It's had some changes over the years, but there were two constants. The much-loved astronomer, Fred Watson, and after the news at 7 o'clock, the quiz. For many years, it remained just a quiz, until James O'Loughlin decided to give it a name.
I wanted to give it a personality, and really, I thought just quietly, if I just do a straight quiz every night for an hour, I'm going to go nuts. And so I wanted to make it something interesting and exciting, selfishly for me, but also for the listeners. So it started by giving it a personality. I said, you know, if you ring up the quiz tonight, you've got to suggest a name for the quiz. But I already had thought of Norman, and I don't know why, it just seemed right. But I think the more, for me, important thing I did was make it a reciprocal relationship. That is, if you want to play the quiz, you've got to answer a nosy question I'm going to pose, something you regret, something to do with bread, something you're proud of. And every night it was different. And we tried to frame it in a way so if someone wasn't comfortable, you know, going deep, they could just say, oh, I really regret not picking the winning lotto numbers and that's fine, we'll move on. But also that it gave people the opportunity, if they wanted, to say, I regret falling out with my mother. And then I could say, oh, how did that happen? Then suddenly this kind of now and again, these incredibly interesting personal conversations initiated by the listener, so I wasn't forcing them into anything, happened in the middle of the quiz. And that's really what I loved about it. I said, I was going to move to Darwin. And in the end, I didn't go. But I didn't want my family to know that I didn't go because I wanted some time away from them. And so they were in Sydney. I was in Sydney. And every couple of weeks, I'd mail a letter to a friend of mine in Darwin and he'd mail it to my family. And I was like, really? Wow. And there's one that stands out, but there were dozens.
On weekends, John Hall and later Bob Hughes had a great understanding of what Sydney listeners wanted on Saturdays and Sundays, a mix of intelligent talk and what these days might be called lifestyle issues. But now, for more than two decades, Simon Marnie has been in the chair on Saturday and Sunday mornings.
I took over weekends from Bob Hughes, who was very much loved by the audience and still is. And so we didn't really move the furniture too much in the initial years. And so the program evolved. We kept things like the gardening, we kept food, we kept what's on entertainment. But then it was decided that the Saturday show from 6 till 8 should be very similar to what was happening weekday breakfast. So we introduced breaking news between 7 and 8. We kept the community stuff between 6 and 7. And then Sundays was just a very organic growth. I must say, it started with me being very much younger and knowing I would be out very late on a Saturday night. So the first half hour was live talkback. The second half hour was pre-recorded music. Third half hour, live talkback, and the last half hour, the Sunday brunch, which has been going now for 23 years.
Food has become a very important part of weekends, and that came about because of a suggestion from the then 702 station manager.
It was Roger Summerall who suggested that I do food as a talkback topic at 11 o'clock because he said, speak to your strengths. And so that format on Sundays hasn't really changed for 15 years.
But none of these programs would work without the incredible generosity and knowledge of our guests, whether they be one-offs, occasionals or regulars. And with Simon Marnie on weekends, there were the Woodies.
The Woodies were a cult classic on weekends, and they came about by accident. I took over from Bob Hughes and used all his regulars, but I couldn't find the old man that talked wood. We had Peter Marcia come in to talk home renovation, but each weekend, you need to talk to the old man that talks wood. And finally, I found Les Miller, and I said to Les, look, we don't have a single spot for you. Why don't you come in with Peter Marcia? And from that moment, this amazing chemistry was born. You had the rude builder, Peter Marcia, with the very urbane, gentlemanly craftsman in Les Miller. And they just clicked, and it was one of the most popular segments on weekends.
Sadly, though, sometimes these beloved guests die, which is what happened with a couple of the Woodies.
That was really hard. We lost two Woodies, Les Miller and the Chief, and the audience were what really made it complete for me. The amount of phone calls respecting Les Miller and then his service at the Auburn Church packed to the gunnels with people from all walks of life but also ABC listeners made it an event that I will now remember fondly. But at the time, yeah, you were fighting back tears as you were trying to do the program.
And it wouldn't be a Sunday morning on ABC Radio in Sydney without Macca, Ian McNamara, whose mix of stories from the city, the country and around the globe is unique in Australian radio. And callers to Australia all over come into the Sydney studio from all over the world.
How are you?
Good, thanks, Damesh.
Yes, I'm listening your program. I'm really feeling like whenever I'm listening your program on every Sunday, I really feeling I'm in Australia and I'm really enjoying the real Australia.
Good on you, Damesh. It's nice to talk.
Love you, Maka.
Mornings has also been the home of high-profile and respected presenters. Caroline Jones, Margaret Throsby, then Jennifer Byrne, Jenny Brockie, Richard Glover, James Valentine, Sally Lohn, Virginia Trioli, the late Deborah Cameron, Linda Mottram and Cassie McCullough. In 2023, it's Sarah McDonald, who was also the first host of a new version of Nightlife when it expanded to weekends. In 1987, after the major changes at 2BL, Andrew Ollie hosted a half-hour program from 8.30 until 9, and that was then extended to 10 a.m. in 1988. His chats with Paul Lynham about federal politics after the 9 o'clock news each morning became the stuff of legend and are still fondly remembered today.
Good morning, Paul.
Good morning, Andrew.
The PM looked a bit titchy yesterday, didn't he?
He did. You might think the idea of the Prime Minister in an election campaign being angry at too many microphones on the rostrum...
That's ironic.
That's what happened at the Opera House. Just get the bloody things out of here, he said. Grabbed a fistful of mics, pushed them into the corner. Let me show you what I want and then you get around it, OK? So the journalists, many of them ended up sitting on the floor with the... microphone outstretched in the arm, which does wonders for your back after about 10 minutes. Then down to Canberra, and a classic case of what you could call Hawk sees red in blue with greens. It should have been a very easy one, launching an environment magazine safe in the portals of the Parliament, but a couple of people who apparently were indeed officially invited had a bit more on their mind than listening to the Prime Minister. Lots of very loud and fairly long comments from the floor during the Prime Minister's speech. The Prime Minister thought he'd deal with this by pointing out that they should exercise a bit of democracy, which in the Prime Minister's terms means you all be quiet and listen to me speak. They weren't too keen on that, so after one had finished, the other one started up and the Prime Minister jumped down off the rostrum beside himself with rage. Barry Jones put his arm around him and said, "Don't go, Bob, don't go." So Bob stayed, and after the interjectors had finished interjecting, he got back up and gave us a fairly short version of the speech. And finished, I thought, in considerably ill grace by turning to the publisher of the magazine and saying, "I congratulate you on your initiative, but not your organisational powers."
Tragically, Andrew Ollie died of a brain tumour in December 1995.
Andrew died peacefully late yesterday after collapsing last Friday with an inoperable brain tumour. Andrew was a fine and decent man. He was a great journalist. He was a great bloke. He was my friend and he was yours too. We're going to miss him.
There was widespread grief at the news, and a public memorial service at the Sydney Town Hall drew thousands of people who paid tribute to one of our most respected broadcasters. A book was published with memories from Andrew's colleagues and listeners, and it was his work on 2BL that meant most to his fans, that he connected with them on radio rather than because of his extensive work on television. Thousands and thousands of calls came into ABC Radio from people expressing their condolences, as those at 2BL were trying to deal with their own grief in losing such a trusted and respected friend and colleague. Peter Wall.
It was the most horrible, horrible time I had at the station. So he came into the office one day and said, "I think there's something wrong with me." And I said, "Well, what's wrong?" He said, "I'm getting giddy and I'm not feeling all that well." I said, "You must take some time off." It went on for a little while, and the next, you know, he's got the brain tumour. The whole station was devastated by it, because he wasn't just a great radio announcer, he was a lovely man. It was the worst thing that happened to me while I was at the station.
But 2 years before Andrew Ollie's death, this remarkable moment for Sydney.
The winner is Sydney.
For the next 7 years after that famous announcement was made, Sydney focused on the Olympic Games, which were held in September and October of 2000. It was a celebration of sport and our city. But sport has always been a part of 2BL, from those first cricket broadcasts in 1924, through Olympics and Commonwealth Games, Davis Cup finals in the 50s and 60s, right up until the Matildas World Cup this year.
They've won the ball back, Australia here. Played forward now towards Sam Kerr. Kerr over the halfway line. Faced up by Millie Bright. Kerr still racing forward. Edge of the box. Sam Kerr shoots right footed. What a strike! What a goal from Sam Kerr! She's been quiet all game, but now she's raised the noise through the roof here. What a goal! Sam Kerr, a long way out from goal, unleashed a shot that left Mary Earps with absolutely no chance, and she's levelled up this World Cup semi-final in stunning fashion.
Tracy Holmes has been a prominent sports journalist on ABC Radio for decades, and things were certainly different when she first began on air in the 1980s.
So we had an office in William Street, and then on weekends we'd get all the old reel-to-reels in the silver canisters and carry them up to Forbes Street to be on air all day, because Grandstand was on air from like 10 a.m. till 6:30 p.m. I was just a trainee then, but what I noticed was that it was bloke-to-bloke men and bloke-to-bloke men's sport. Yeah. And I thought I might start something, just a little 15-minute program, because it will help me, you know, get interviews and learn how to do interviews and learn how to edit and splice it all together. So I started a 15-minute segment called Women in Sport, which they listened to and went, oh, that's okay. They started playing that. And I mean, in the end, they didn't need that anymore, because women's sport just became quite natural for Grandstand.
And that experience led to a great moment.
They sent me down to the Netball World Cup. It was during rugby league, you know, and they were crossing to me as part of the around the grounds to see what were the scores in the other games. So they crossed to me down there, and I said, it's just phenomenal. They could hear the crowd in the background. And David Morrow ended up saying, listen, that's far more exciting than the game we're at. Why don't you stay with it? And so that was the first time I actually did live commentary of a sports event through to the end, and a really dramatic final. And, of course, the Australians in tears because they were celebrating, and the Kiwis just completely devastated, and the crowd going berserk. It was wonderful. And I remember crossing back to David, and it took a while for him to pick up, and I didn't know if it was a technical difficulty at my end or I just couldn't hear him, but he was actually crying because it was so fantastic. And, yeah, that's one of my lasting memories before I ended up becoming the host of Grandstand as the first female host of a national sports show in this country.
This is ABC Radio Sydney and our 100th birthday celebration. You're with Rod Quinn on ABC Radio Sydney as we celebrate 100 years. For 50 years, half the ABC's life, Jim Maxwell has been a prominent sporting commentator, calling many sports, including rugby league and rugby union, Olympic and Commonwealth Games events, and, most importantly, the cricket. He began at 2BL in the old days at Upper Forbes Street and worked with many of the legends of ABC Sport. Some of those men were the people who decided who got the much sought-after position of trainee in the ABC Sports Department.
Well, it was Bernie Kerr was the boss of sport, been there forever. John O'Reilly, I think, Alan Marks and Bert Oliver, they were the principal people involved in that process.
And how did the audition and application process work? Jim Maxwell explains.
It went like this. Come in, we'll do a Q&A in sport just to find out if you know anything at all. Next one, you had to write and read your opinion on certain topics. Should Australia be playing rugby against South Africa, I think was one going back, and that's it. And then the last one, if you got to that point, was the audition calling sport, because calling the sport was the main event. I had a choice. New South Wales Open Tennis, White City, Australia-Pakistan Test Cricket SCG. So I took the cricket and I did 20 minutes into the old Niagara at the back of the MA Noble stand and off it went. So by that stage we've been through about three processes to get down to, I think it was three people. I started work in April the 6th, 1973, and I was subsequently told that I got the job over the others because of the quality of my cricket broadcast at the SCG, which was very pleasing. It wasn't until many years later that I discovered the main person I was up against was David Morrow, who by then had got into the ABC, but I never knew at that time.
And there was plenty of sport on 2BL in the 1970s. And although then, as now, the emphasis is on calling live sport on the weekends, there were sporting programs on 2BL during the week as well.
Then the main daily output on the ABC in those days, remembering we did radio and television, was on radio at 6:30, and the Thunder and Lightning, the sporting highlights. And also remember, at that point, we were not allowed to record people on the phone. We had to go out and do every interview or pinch it off the wire, the line from the BBC, if we could find the sound, the audio. And we did 15 minutes before Blue Hills every night. And then we did the Sportsman's Parade on Friday night, which was an extended version full of previews of the weekend sport. And then the roundup on Saturday and Sunday. Saturday following a lengthy afternoon of racing, rugby league, or AFL, whatever it may be. And Sunday, well, we didn't do anything on Sunday because there was nothing on Sunday in those days. But there was nothing to do until a few years later. We tended to pre-record a chunk of it in a little studio down in William Street, 164 William Street, where the ABC office was for sport. And then we'd run across the road at 6:25 and scootle up to the Forbes Street and hand the tape to the bloke, the tech, and you'd go on, you'd do a little bit live normally and then throw to the tape and that was it. That was the main event every day. But around that, of course, there was sport on the weekend. And you used to, as a trainee, go as an observer. That was, you'll go out and observe how John O'Reilly calls the rugby league and Alan Marks and so on. So you spent a fair bit of time observing. But also, at that time, they got hold of a fellow who'd been a very long-serving announcer in the ABC and had moved up to be studio supervisor and had then retired. Lovely fellow, Gordon Scott. So he used to come in once a week and he'd sit down and he'd underline, say, a newspaper report and ask me to read it. So it was all about getting timing, emphasis right, and it was very helpful, very helpful. I didn't get any other instruction other than how to present myself on air. But the rest of it was a bit of a lucky dip because you had to sit in the wings watching how everyone else did it. And that was good for me and cricket because McGilvray, I thought, was the best. And I used to sit behind him and watch the game and listen to his interpretation of it all. And I think I learned more about the technique of broadcasting cricket from him than anybody else.
Although 2BL, later rebadged in 2000 as 702 ABC Sydney and then in 2017 simply as ABC Radio Sydney, had dispensed with specialist programs during the week, there was still plenty of room for them on weekends. John Nutting presented Saturday Night Country for more than a decade, earning the respect of Australia's leading musicians. John Cleary brought an intelligent and thoughtful approach to spiritual matters late on Sunday nights. Speaking Out dealt with the concerns of Australia's Indigenous peoples. Sunday Profile was a half-hour in-depth interview with a major newsmaker. And then there was one of the great cult programs on ABC Radio, the Could Have Been Champions, which went out nationally from 7 until 10 on Sunday nights in the 1990s. It was a delicious mix of looking at the small details of life. Magic moments, celebrity spotting, sporting news, the occasional guest, and live music as well, especially from Golden Guitar-winning Greg Champion, whose witty songs about Australian life were a weekly highlight.
I've played a chanceless innings and I earned every run, and I made 100 in the backyard at Mum's.
In the new millennium, as television resorted to a seemingly endless stream of competition and so-called reality programs, radio concentrated on what it's always done best, giving interesting people a space to talk, and no program did that with more success than Conversations. Usually just one guest for an hour a day, and hosted by former comedian Richard Feidler, it became a sensation, especially on a new listening platform, the podcast. For about 80 years, radio was a medium that was very much of the moment. You had to be there and listening if you wanted to hear your favourite program. Podcasts changed all that and allowed radio listeners the chance to hear stories, guests and interviews when they wanted to. And Conversations was at the forefront with over a million subscribers to this new format. But what radio still does better than its junior rivals is dealing with breaking news. And 702 was there as a world-changing story unfolded. With Tony Delroy away at a radio conference, his prize after being named the ABC's inaugural Broadcaster of the Year, Weekend's host Simon Marnie was in the nightlife chair when the September 11 attacks happened.
It was around about 11:30. We were doing what the papers say, and Peter Crean from the Melbourne Age was giving his report. Peter, normally very professional, but started getting distracted. And I said, is everything okay, Peter? And he said, we're getting reports of a plane flying into a building in New York. And I said, oh, okay. And then proceeded to continue. And he said, look, Simon, I've got to go. There's been a second plane accident in the United States. And from that moment on, it just turned into a whirlwind. What I found interesting was the internet was the first thing to fall over for information. Television went shortly after that because it became blanket CNN coverage. And radio was the last method of communication for those in Australia. We would have lost it, but Tony Delroy had a regular listener at the Telstra Exchange in Geelong who played the quiz with somebody at AT&T in Houston, Texas. She kept that line open for us. And so unlike any other media organisation, we were able to put calls through to America because the phone lines became congested and you couldn't get through. So thanks to this person who I never know, we were able to cover the whole of September 11 through their work. What was then to unfold was it was a brand new midnight to dawn announcer to take over at 2 o'clock. What had happened was that when all the ABC employees who were listening heard this was happening, came in to help with the broadcast. The control room was full of people who wanted to be there to share the news. The Midnight at Dawn announcer stayed in the control room and helped get up all the people that we managed to speak to in New York, in Washington, and around the states. But then at 6 o'clock in the morning, the Perth program said, our breakfast presenters want to keep the coverage that you're doing. So we then went from 6 o'clock in the morning till 9 o'clock in the morning. It was 10 p.m. till 9 a.m. that the nightlife team, with me, presented September 11.
Just recapping that explosions have rocked both Washington and New York. The Pentagon has been attacked. The World Trade Center is no more. After earlier on between 8 and 9, two planes separated about 18 to 25 minutes apart crashed into each tower of the World Trade Center.
And sometimes the news breaks much closer to home, like in Martin Place.
We've just got some breaking news. There's a police operation underway in the heart of the city. One block of Martin Place has been cordoned off between Elizabeth Street and Phillip Street, and several police vehicles are at the scene. An ABC reporter has seen one officer with a weapon drawn.
Well, look, I was walking up Martin Place earlier on my way to work at Macquarie Street, and I was stopped from crossing the road. At that stage, there were a handful of police crouched around the corner from the Lint Building in Martin Place. But now we've got a whole block of Martin Place blocked off. There are dozens and dozens of police. Some are very heavily armed in helmets and Kevlar suits. When I was allowed a little closer, I could see inside the Lint Building a woman with her hands up against the glass. Looks like a sort of, you know, potential robbery or hostage situation.
In March 2020, a virus that originated in a Chinese city spread around the world, and life as we know it was turned upside down. And just as millions of Australians worked from home, so did some of the presenters on ABC Radio Sydney. Richard Glover and Simon Marnie, most notably, broadcast from their lounge rooms and kept Sydney up to date with what we all needed to know.
The thing I really liked about broadcasting from home during COVID was you were in your home and the audience was in their home. You were close to the kitchen, they were close to the kitchen. You could wander to your own bathroom just as they did. And so there was a real connection, not just with being trapped within the 5K zone, but a connection to how people were listening to me. The only downside, of course, was every time the garbage trucks went by or a plane flew over. But otherwise, I really feel that broadcasting from home gave me an even greater connection to the audience.
And Radio National's medical expert, Dr. Norman Swan, became a familiar and reassuring voice on local radio, answering questions from listeners and giving calm, factual information at a time when it was needed the most. Of course, in this new world, his podcast, dubbed the CoronaCast, was essential listening as well. The COVID years proved, once again, how important accurate information from a trusted source was to a city such as Sydney. Just like in the Depression or World War II, the global financial crisis, on election nights, both state and federal, referendums, leadership spills, sporting triumphs and tragedies, during breaking news stories and natural disasters like storms and bushfires. And just as we've always been there for the people of Sydney, you have always been there for us. Tuning in on the AM dial at 857 740 or 702. On radios at home, in cars and trucks, on transistors, stereos and boomboxes, and now on the ABC Listen app, on smartphones, tablets and smartwatches, and even on TV sets on Channel 25. When we ask for callers, you are there. And with text messages, Facebook posts, tweets, Instas and emails, and many people still send letters in the old-fashioned way, the way that Charles Moses asked people to get in contact with 2BL when they wanted to know who was on the air. No matter what changes take place, ABC Radio in Sydney will be there and at the forefront. And now it's time to change again, just as 2SB became 2BL, which became Radio 1, then 702BL, and then 702ABC Sydney, and now simply ABC Radio Sydney. Just as those first broadcasts came from Phillip Street, and then Coogee, then Pitt Street, Elizabeth Street, Market Street, William Street, Upper Forbes Street, and Harris Street Ultimo. The next step will be into a new building closer to the heart of Sydney in Parramatta. It's part of who we are and what we do. Although it's important to look back, it's even more important to look ahead. In 2023, this special celebration year, Steve Ahern is our station manager at ABC Radio Sydney.
Well, what a fascinating look back at 100 years of the history of 2SB, then 2BL, and the station now known as ABC Radio Sydney. I wonder what the next 100 years will be like. Let me speculate a bit. In the last 100 years, we were dominated by live linear broadcast radio. Somebody in a studio just like this one made a program, played some music, talked to people, and people heard that live through the transmitter. Nowadays, and into the future, there's so many different ways of being able to consume the audio we make. You can hear it back by a digital platform. Maybe you'll listen to it as a podcast. You might listen to something that was broadcast a year ago, but it sits there in the podcast universe and it's available for anyone, anywhere, anytime in the future to listen to. Then there's the short-term catch-up of just being able to listen back to something that you might have missed. So using our apps, you can go back, you can rewind, you can listen back to something that was on a few hours ago using the catch-up service. The role of apps puts radio back into the pocket, going back to the 60s, the 70s, the transistor radio was the thing that people took with them in their pockets. Radio was truly portable. Well, it is again. The phone app again puts radio into your pocket. And I think one of the emerging powers of audio into the future will be smart speakers. You can speak back to us, not by phoning up, just by saying, send this message to ABC Radio Sydney. So smart speakers are going to deliver a whole new range of instant, easy access to radio by being able to talk directly back, not having to ring up, not having to wait your turn in a talkback queue, but just being able to instantly interact. And in so many ways, smart speakers are going to link audio with the power of search on the internet and the power to time shift and place shift so that it will deliver all the content that we make in very different ways and much easier ways to our audience. So I think the future is very exciting. None of us know what audio or the platform formerly known as radio will be like in the future. But to me, I see a very exciting future and roll on the next 100 years of audio.
As we close this look at 100 years of ABC Radio Sydney, we can thank and acknowledge the extraordinary contributions of hundreds of announcers, thousands of producers, managers and other off-air staff, hundreds of thousands of guests, and most important of all, millions of listeners. Without all of them, none of this would have been possible. And we wish all of you and everyone who has worked on this station or listened to it over the last 100 years a very happy 100th birthday.
This is the ABC.
In Sydney, it's 2BL for better listening.
Come closer now. Come closer to your radios, everybody.
It's really quite overwhelming.
Radio that relates to your morning.
2BL was the popular station.
That is bloody magnificent!
This is an interesting story.
Look, I'd like you to take a listen to this.
It has a responsibility to reflect the environment and the climate in which it's operating.
This is 2BL. Stay tuned to the best in Sydney.
ABC Radio Sydney's 100th birthday celebration special was written, produced and presented by Rod Quinn. Music production, additional audio research and an extra sprinkling of magic by Jake Round. Research by Therese Abbey, and there was early research by Amanda Roberts. And now, in the great tradition of ABC Radio and ABC Radio Sydney since 1923, it's now time for the latest news.
What about Spike Milligan?